second part, Nunzio Alì. Nunzio Alì, he's a postdoctorate student in USP. And the subject he's presenting is rights and inequality in Brazil.
Thank you very much. First of all, I have to thank the organization to give me the opportunity to present my work here, in particular Professor Pinzani. For me, it's a particular pleasure to come back to the Università Federale di Santa Caterina, where recently I obtained my PhD. And my presentation today focuses precisely on the main argument of my PhD thesis, that concerns with economic inequality and social justice. Of course, I have not the time and the space to present all aspects of my research, but I hope I will be able to clarify my proposal regarding two fundamental questions about the issue of economic inequality. First, why is economic inequality unjust? And second, when is it, or better, which is the extent of this economic inequality can be legitimate and non-arbitrary? And I prefer to formulate this second question in this term. How rich should the 1% be? First of all, I should clarify that I am not interested to know whether economic inequality could be bad or good, which is a theological point of view. We have different reasons, several reasons, for which reason inequality is objectionable. For example, they can affect our environmental, natural environmental, or their affect well health and other reason. But by contrast, I will try to answer this question from a theological point of view. So I want to know if inequality can violate some rights and duty. For this reason, the title of my presentation is Right Inequality, and moreover, I will focus most of all on Brazilian distribution, which present an exemplary case of extreme economic inequality. We might begin this investigation asking ourselves if we have a right to be equal. Nowadays, a formal moral equality is widely accepted. Even Nazi or other libertarians accept the basic moral equality, but it is not run that we should also make individuals equal in their material condition, such wealth, income, or other particular good. Therefore, a substantial of equality is more controversial, as well as the idea that the difference in terms of goods between people matter. On the contrary, in trying to answer the fundamental question when and why is economic inequality unjust, I am interested in testing the hypothesis whether the gap between the most and the least advantage in terms of income and wealth matter. In the current debate, this question seems to be attacked precisely to a certain idea of equality. It seems that the gap between the best off and the worst off matters only if we adopt an intrinsic concern for inequality. It means that a reduction of the gap between the most and the least advantage would be in itself an improvement. In the other words, those who advocate this intrinsic argument, they are answering yes to the question if we have a right to be equal also in substantive terms. However, this assumption seems implausible because it sustains a diminution of inequality simply for the sake of equality as moral value. Thus, an intrinsic concern for inequality is exposed to the famous left-down objection. Quoting the definition provided by Parfit, the objection appealed to the case where if some inequality were removed, that would be worse for some people and better for no one. Therefore, we must provide a compelling argument to avoid the lockdown objection. The solution could be to adopt a non-intrinsic argument against inequality. That is, the objection against inequality has to do with its consequence and not with the value of equality itself. It means that we have a reason to reduce inequality only when and only because our way of doing so benefits in set form those who are less advantaged. There are two broader ways to individuate in which terms we could benefit the less advantaged, and they depend on the kind of conception of social justice we endorse. In the current debate, we can observe two different ways to do it. That correspond to what reinforced on and before Iris Young called two pictures of justice. The allocative distributive conception of justice and the relational conception of justice. The former adopt a distributed-centered point of view, and therefore the just distribution is assessed in absolute terms of what people have. Although there can be different interpretation of what good should be distributed, the metric of justice, wealth, resource, or capability, and according to which criteria or principle, for example, prioritarian, insufficientness, or different principle, all this distributive account, for all this distributive account, the problem is not the gap in inequality between the best of and the worst of, but the point at which inequality is no longer normative, significant, wherever this gap would be. In case of sufficientism, is a minimal threshold for all that we should ensure for our citizens or for all people in the world, depending on the theoretical position. For prioritarianism, is the maximization of position of worst of. And of course, the different principle is similar, depending if you adopt a lex-min or max-min interpretation. The most common distributive theories, justice, adopt the allocative distributive view. By contrast, the relational conception of justice, second picture, focus on inter-subject relation and structure, and its basic question of justice is not what we have, but how we are treated. In this case, I quote Forst, but many relational egalitarian or social egalitarian defend this point of view. From this point of view, we have several reasons to reduce the difference between the best of and the worst of, even if this reduction does not entail an improvement in terms of goods or the position of worst of. Indeed, the kind of benefit that occurs here is related with status, control, equality of opportunity, political fairness, equal concern, fair distribution of income and wealth, only to mention the six reasons provided very recent by Thomas Scallon in Why Does Inequality Matter? In this sense, according to Scallon, and I agree, the inequality can be objectionable because for several reasons, for example, because it creates a humiliated different status, or because inequality gives a strong power on the hand of the rich people against who have less, and because undermine the fairness of political institution, and so on and so forth. Now, I agree with Scammer that these different reasons have a certain specificity, but I don't have the time to argue about all these questions. In my idea, we can resume this dimension of inequality in one more strong notion, that is domination, because I think that for example, the question of power cut through all this dimension of justice. And for example, if you have a strong economic power, you can convert or translate this into political power, but also the fairness of distribution of income and wealth depend also from your bargaining power. Then I think that what matters, the first question of justice, as Forst says, but I agree, is which rules, primary rules, legal, social, and political, shape and establish which are the fundamental institution, social institution, or in the Russian term, the basic structure. And I think that the point is the basic structure of society, and these several reasons that Scallon has explicitly are strictly linked with this this notion, but I think that is enough clear as in scale on why inequality is unjust, and if we can turn the discussion in terms of rights, the point is that maybe we don't have a right to be equal in terms of good, for such as income and wealth, but sure we have a right not to be too much unequal. The point is the amount of inequality between, for example, the two extreme position of the distribution, the bottom and the top. This assumption makes me to turn the second question I have placed at the beginning. Not only why is economic inequality unjust, but when is it? Or in other words, the question which distributive injustice, if any, we should adopt. On the current debate, we can realize that on the one hand, the allocative distributive view has the advantage to provide a distributive criterion of justice, so that, for instance, economic inequality is unjust when a society does not ensure a sufficient socioeconomic threshold for all or the maximization of position of staff. But these distributive criteria are in principle compatible with an unlimited common inequality. I think that they are not egalitarian at all, because does matter the difference between what the poor or the worst off have and what the best off have. On the other hand, the relational conception of justice provides strong reason for which the gap between the most and the less advantaged in terms of income and wealth or other good matter, but those who endorse this view usually say very little about the distributive criteria of justice, and therefore they are not able to answer adequately the question how much rich should the 1% be. But I think that we should make an effort to provide an answer, otherwise our objection against inequality remains quite indeterminate. Only in this way, only if we make an effort to determine this kind of stand of inequality, we can offer a full contribution of the public debate regarding the kind of public policy that have direct or indirect distributive outcomes, permit a productive multidisciplinary approach with economy, sociology, and political science, and above all, compel the public administration to provide accountability on the real dimension of income and wealth inequality among their citizens. At the first sight, by considering the common inequality unjust, when it overcomes a certain gap between the most and the less disadvantaged, seems to be problematic. Because we might lose the possibility to provide an objective criterion to establish the arbitrariness of a common inequality. Instead, the sufficient is more prioritariness or difference principle give this kind of determination in evaluating the economy inequality. This is an important preoccupation, but this is not the case. Indeed, we can observe that if economy inequality is morally and politically objectable, only in this case, in the case in which it reaches a certain range, a certain gap, we should prescribe a distributive criterion just that does not permit any potentially unlimited economy inequality. Therefore, in my opinion, the criterion that we are looking for is one of proportionality. Namely, we should establish the limit range of economy inequality between the best of and the worst of. To be sure, the idea of proportionality as a criterion of material or substantive justice is not new. Indeed, in its origin can be traced from ancient political philosophy with Plato, Aristotle, and to the modern time with Rousseau. For example, Plato, in the Law, Book 5, sustained that no one should be more than four times richer than the poorest member of the society. Instead, Aristotle argued that about proportional equality in Politics, Book 5. He condemns extreme material inequality because they produce a situation in which the poor and the rich are not able to establish a just constitution and government. Rousseau, in the Social Contract, sustained that no citizen should be so rich that he can buy another, and no one so poor that he is compelled to sell himself. Although Rousseau rejects absolute wealth and power equality because it's too severe and demanding, he argues that the distance between the rich and the poor should be as close as possible. But in the contemporary debate, the idea of proportionality as a requirement or criteria of justice has been almost abandoned. I only quote interesting attempt, political attempt, to fix instead a proportionality in Switzerland in 2013, December 2013, a public referendum properly took place of this proposal, trying to establish the ratio of 1 to 12 between the executive pay and the lowest pay in the company. The proposal was defeated with 65% of vote. The participation was 53%. Likely, the ratio 1 to 12 was too narrow. This, maybe it contributed to the rejection of the proposal. My proposal of the ratio is less demanding, as I will show further. Now, in the In the second part of my presentation, I need to explain the normative implication of distributive criteria of proportionality. The first question that I have to answer is whether the exact acceptable gap of common inequality, income and wealth between the most and last advantage should and could be decided in theory, in theory. Is it difficult to answer this question? But I argue that it is possible to answer yes, but we should understand it just as a proposal that must be submitted to evaluation of public opinion and public deliberation, and we should take in mind the difference between the normative theoretical assumption, the distributive criteria of proportionality itself, and its application, the exact extent or the concrete permissible range of a common inequality that I will propose. There are many ways to measure economic inequality, for example, synthetic index such as Gini coefficient, Tell index, altitude index. But for my proposal, and for my purpose, I think that Piketty distribution tables indicate the shared values of deciles, centiles into total income and total wealth separately, are the most adequate method to analyze economic inequality. First, the evaluation in terms of decile and centiles perfectly grasps the current concern against the enormous increase of inequality in favor of the top 1%. Second, Piketty distribution tables permit to determine the exact extent on which a disproportionate share of growth has been captured by the top end of the distribution, the 1%. And permit to distinguish income and wealth, which have different impact of the common inequality. Gini coefficient and the other index are not so useful to distinguish income and wealth. Lastly, Piketty distribution tables are also valuable because they force everyone to take note of the share of income and the wealth of different social groups, particularly the bottom 50% that he calls the lower class, and the top central 1% that he calls the dominant class. Therefore, using this method, I argue that nobody should earn more than 18 times of the average income post-tax of the bottom 50% of distribution. This is the first. And the second, nobody should own more than 100 times of the average wealth per adult of the bottom 50%. I believe that it could be a compelling answer to the question, how rich should the 1% be? And the case of economy inequality in Brazil and its brief confrontation with Italy and the United States could offer a clear picture. Inequality is always a multiple dimensional concept, and I am focused on an economic inequality and the vertical inequality. However, in a broad picture, we should also consider the horizontal inequality, for instance, gender and racial inequality, and the vertical and the horizontal inequality affect each other. And it is particularly true in the case of Brazilian inequality. But for this time, I can spend all a few times arguing about the economy inequality in Brazil. Brazil is one of the most unequal countries on the world, particularly unequal also for the average of Latin American inequality. According to the World Inequality Report, according to the World Inequality Report in 2018, the top 1% owing 27.8% of Brazil's total income. The most common interpretation of Brazilian inequality asserted that the root of such high inequality lies in the extractive institutions set up during the colonial era. But the recent studies based on income tax data, the same method that Piketty used, instead of classic survey methodology, weaken this hypothesis and provide us an alternative explanation that Brazil missed out the great labor period. Although not totally. The Great Labor Period is the period between the end of the Second World War and the end of 17 or the beginning of 18, which corresponds to the great equal period of income and wealth in Europe, in particular in the United States. Indeed, at the beginning of the 20th century, the level of inequality in Brazil and Europe is quite similar. Of course, it was the Belle Époque, which correspond to the highest level of inequality in Europe in particular. But although the Second World War provoked a sharp decline in the concentration of income at the top in the most rich countries, both due to the policy and the sheer destruction of the Second World, in Brazil it had the opposite effect, and the country became much more unequal than other European countries in the United States for the most part of the 20th century. Most recently, the steep rise in inequality in the United States made it the only rich country to rival to Brazilian labor inequality, according to top income shares. Brazil experienced a sharp increase of top shares of distribution during the two periods of dictatorial rule, the Estado Novo, in the period of the Second World War, and the military dictatorship of 1964 to 1985. And an opposite phenomenon of decrease of inequality only during the late 1950s, particularly during the Juscelino-Kubitschinski administration, and a more modest decrease after the redemocratization, starting in 1988. After this very brief overview, I turn on the application of the rights on equality that they suggested. I think that a society which is able to maintain regularly the ratio of 1 to 18 in income and the ratio of 1 to 100 in wealth could be described as a realistic utopia. Taking into account the Piketty's historical analysis of economy inequality, the ratio 1 to 18 income draws a distribution that is more unequal than the most egalitarian developed capitalist society in recent times, which correspond to the country in Scandinavia during the 17th and the 18th, but is less unequal, at least, than at the medium inequality society like Europe nowadays. Someone could believe that the ratio 1 to 18 in income is too demanding. However, I can point out how this range allows some to earn in just 2 years as much as a person at the bottom of 15 gains on average through its almost entire work life, 13 is 6 years. I think that those who are situated at the very top of the distribution cannot reasonably claim more than this. On the other hand, for those who believe that my ratio is still not egalitarian enough, I can remind them that my proposal aimed to be realistic and feasible. Indeed, if the range I proposed might not seem so radical for European countries, although it would be a big egalitarian improvement also for Europe, it would have a revolutionary impact in countries like United States, which the top 1% earn on average around 40 times more than the bottom, 50%, or like precisely Brazil, which also presents an extreme income inequality. The case of Brazil is an exemplary case of kind of a radical effect that could have the kind of range that I proposed. Indeed, in Brazil, the top 1% had on average around 36 times more than the bottom, 50%. In numbers, the top 1 had on average 27,000 reais a month, and the bottom earned just 747 reais a month. The first group is composed by 889,000 individuals, the bottom by almost 45 million. In Brazilian case, actually, the 1 to 18 ratio would mean that nobody should earn more than around 13,500 reais a month post-tax, given that the bottom actually have average 747. This means the multiplication for 18 times. Now, it is evident that not all people who earn more than this amount are really super rich and they belong to dominant elite. The point is that in Brazil, the Brazilian distribution is extremely unequal, even among the top 1%. On the one hand, there are a few tens of thousands of citizens who earn an astronomical income. Indeed, why Brazil is half as rich as France and less than one-third as rich as the United States, it's a little benefit from similar magnitude of income. On the other hand, while the rich in Brazil has like the richest and developed countries, the rest are much poorer. Indeed, there are millions of citizens at the bottom 30% who earn considerably less than the minimum wage established by law. The range of the proposal must clear and condemn this extreme inequality, but it does not mean that tomorrow, in the unlikely hypothesis that the Brazilian government would accomplish my range, the best strategy would be a taxation of 100% of all wage that overcome the actual admissible ratio. On the contrary, a similar strategy behind the rising serious doubt of legitimacy is surely inefficient and enforceable. The range of the proposal is a proportionality and not a top threshold. This is the main difference with another criterion, which is known as limitarianism, proposed by Ingrid Robbins, which establishes a threshold for the top, for the rich people. It means that if we start reducing the extreme common inequality and the economic concentration at the very top of distribution and increase the average income of the bottom 50%, we soon realize that many people that nowadays earn more than permissible range, thus who are the very bottom of the 1% group, in the short middle run will be situated into the permissible range. It means that implementing a criterion of justice in an unjust society is always a matter of transitional justice. However, in case of other countries with a less extreme inequality distribution, my ratio of 1 to 18 might have less radical effect. For example, a concrete application of this ratio of the Italy and the United States income distribution showed that the range I proposed does not allow only an excessive inequality, and it constrains mainly the earnings of those people who are situated at the very top of this 1% group. In the case of Italy, a ratio of 1 to 19 would prescribe that nobody should earn more than 238,000 euro a year post-tax, given that the bottom 50% and the average around 13,200 euros for a year post-tax. In Italy, actually, all around the top 0.2% earn more than this amount. Meanwhile, in case of the United States, the effect might be more pronounced. In Italy, Italy income distribution is not particularly unequal. Instead, in Italy, the wealth distribution is very pronounced. In this case, United States case, the ratio that I proposed means that nobody should earn more than $450,000 a year, given that the bottom 15% earned an average on $20,000 a year post-tax, which corresponds to the 19.5% of total income. Now, we can observe that the top 1% earned on average around $1 billion a year. But the point is that in the United States, the level of earning that the top 0.1% can reach is very, very high. So, into the top 1% group, all apart would earn effectively more than $450,000 a year. Likely those who are belong to the top 0.3%, given that just the top 0.1% had on average $4,400,000. In the case of the United States, my proposal means a redistribution of approximately 7% of total national income. Both cases, Italy and the United States, made my proposal more feasible in the medium run than in case of Brazil. However, one of the most effective strategies to raise the average of income in the bottom 50% is to realize an egalitarian, as much as possible, wealth distribution. In this way, people at the bottom might increase their bargaining power, their education, job formation, and so on. For this reason, we should take seriously the question of wealth inequality and treat it in a separate way with income. I sustain that nobody should own more than 100 times the average wealth per adult of the bottom 50%. The ratio that they proposed in wealth is also far to represent a low wealth inequality society, which could correspond an ideal wealth distribution, taking consideration the Piketty analysis. Instead, it might be a medium wealth inequality society, one that, with a certain approximation, might correspond to Scandinavia in counties in the 17th to 18th. The ratio 1 to 100 between the average wealth of the bottom 50% and the wealthiest constrain mainly those who are situated at the very top of wealth distribution. Although this ratio are low, however, consistent wealth inequality between the top and the bottom distribution, it would be a great egalitarian advance in respect to our actual wealth inequality societies such as Europe, mid-high inequality society, which are characterized typically by a ratio between the average wealth of the bottom 15 and the average wealth of the top one of 1 to 200 or 1 to 250. The difference depends on the European account that we take as example. Clearly, in the countries like United States, Brazil, and Russia, with a very high wealth inequality, typically with a ratio between the bottom 15% and the top one of 1 to 350, my proposal might entail a sort of distributive revolution. Unfortunately, accurate and comparable data of wealth inequality in Brazil are not available due to the problem of collecting them. The economists have difficulty to collect the data, and the Brazilian legislation prescribes a very low and puzzle wealth taxation. This example said much about how the wealth distribution is underestimated in the Brazilian, and how this topic is not in the core of the public debate, and the legislation and the government doesn't offer any accountability about this data. So, to make clear the implication of the range in wealth that I proposed, I will take in account briefly all the distribution of wealth in Italy. The last slide. Actually, in Italy case, according to the ratio that I proposed, nobody should own more than 2.3 million euros per adult, given that the bottom 50% own, on average, around 20,000 euros per adult. Instead, the top 1% on average almost 4 million euros per adult. In this case also, the ratio proposed limits the wealth accumulation at the very top of the distribution. Indeed, we should be aware that within the group of the top 1% with an average of 4 million euros per adult, there are some people who earn wealth of billions of euros. For example, in 2017 Forbes list of world's billionaires, we find within the first 100 position three Italians with the individual wealth precisely of 17.9 billion dollars or 13.9 billion dollars. Thank you.